Okay, now we're ready to experiment. What's different? Notice anything? We're now going to move from a mode of drawing and sketching and kind of thinking and experimenting in our brain to toys. Notice on my desk, indeed the whole office, is just a giant junkyard of stuff. Some stuff that's worked really great, some stuff that hasn't worked so great. All kinds of things from these dudes. What are these? Why are these shapes all ripply bumply? This is a concept we had once for massaging soap, how to minimize the amount of soap, but it's got to be strong so it doesn't break. So then it feels good when it runs on your body. But it doesn't take up a lot of weight for hotels and stuff. So now we want to experiment. We're thinking about this drill press and how to move the table around. And for now, we're going to assume that we take a random part and it goes on the drill press and we want to drill a hole in it. But then we got to move it and position it. See, here's the table. It's kind of crunchy for us to move it this way. Is there a better, more simple way to move the table around and position the part? And you also got to be thinking of not just move this table in terms of change of the design, but what would I sell, for example, as a retrofit for just everything that already exists? So always want to keep that in mind, too. Okay, so we want to experiment. We want to try different things. And remember, earlier we were talking about two basic approaches, two kinds of concepts that we arrived at. One was an articulated or revolute joints. And we got that by standing back. Remember, that was the forward steps of moving around this way. And the second one was the Cartesian design, the linear or Cartesian, which was just starting at the base or the part and moving back toward the base, left and right. And how are we going to explore these different ideas? Well, one of the ways you do is you go out and you play with hardware that exists already. You play with different parts. You build different, they're called sketch models. Sketch models are made from just stuff you've got lying around, like wood. You know, you go to the shop, this is a sketch model, and what do you think those things are in there for? Is this for a table that moves back and forth? What is this thing for? Why did I make this? And you can make stuff with wood really quick. You can make stuff with cardboard, push pins. One of my favorite for machines is using building blocks, like these are Legos. And you can do all kinds of neat linkages and stuff with your Legos. You can explore motions. And you can say, wait a second. Huh, that's interesting. What if I change this? What if I make this baseline here longer? What kind of motion do I then get? And as you're moving with your fingers to make stuff, you're starting to wire your brain with exploring about what happens. You're building into your brain, whoa, check it out. Look at that. It goes, moves, and moves, and moves, and moves, and then it goes, whoa! Wow, it didn't do that before. Let's do that again. Wow. And you want to play. See, look at this. This is kind of nice and, oh, ooh, ah, that's really good. So that's a good design. And then you think, well, wait a second. When I did it this way, oh, that's a bad design because it goes unstable. Not necessarily bad. Maybe I want to apply a huge force for clamping my part down. Can I use this snapping process somehow? Huh. Can I use that somehow? Turns out that was already invented a while ago with vice grips. And watch what happens when these links here slowly get close to center, 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 and then now, with a little bit of force in the handle, you get infinite crushing grip in the jaws! Ah. That instability can be used. Remember, 1 over ouch equals ah. One of the very, very important points of experimentation with physical stuff around you is you're not going to design just one thing in life. You can design a lot of stuff. So there is no such thing as failure or a waste of time in the early stages of design thinking. Because what you don't use here, file away in the brain. Remember, look for things that are different because you may use them again later. You'll do a lot of real experiments. We call them bench level experiments. Yeah, you got a hypothesis. You've done some analysis. Oh, I'm not really sure. Is it right or not? Particular things involving friction or feedback, right? And an experiment and make sure your circuit is stable. A bench level prototype, as opposed to a simple experiment. These would be simple experiments here to prove things out. A bench level prototype is I will actually start putting real parts together. So I'll take real linear bearing modules, right? And I'll build a real machine from them. And I'll be able to test it under real loads. And then ideally, I'm done. And that doesn't happen very often. But it starts giving you ideas of what the real system can operate at. And then when you're doing this experimentation, you identify risky things. Oh, risk maybe, I want to get this nice motion, but the risk is that I may get a singularity. So you always start identifying the things that may go wrong by experimentation. Because when you do a nice linear model, y equals mx plus b, that's nice, there's no instabilities in there. But if you've modeled something with a simple linear idea, and it's got a nonlinear term in it you didn't model, you won't discover until you build and release the product and they start coming back. That's why you've got to identify those unmodeled nonlinear terms, in particular during experimentation. Playing with parts is the way, a fantastic way for experimenting. You will typically have some array of things that are available to you in the design. Sometimes you're lucky to have everything available. Play with what you are given. Play with what you're not given. Maybe go back and say, excuse me, I wasn't given this, but I have this, and it doesn't cost that much more. Can I use that? Because look how much better it can be. Sketch models. So you see in the pictures, sketch models wood. I've got this great idea for, you know, how we can locate things very precisely. I can take my fixture, I can put it over here, I can have three or four fixtures with different parts. And then I put them on and they all locate exactly. Wait a second. This is supposed to locate exactly and it's rotating. Huh? Professor Slocum told us about kinematic couplings and how wonderful they are. And you look and you see, wait a second, my grooves aren't aligned properly. My grooves have to be facing inward. You see, I had that. When we go through the topic on kinematics, you'll see how you actually know that. I don't know that now. At least I pretend not to. But the grooves are one way and it didn't work, right? The grooves were this way and the thing, well, I had no clue where I am. So I solved the problem by, oh, I can go and analyze this and run finite element analysis and equations and hire consultants. Maybe I should just flip the grooves around, and because they don't work one way, maybe they'll work the other way. Let's try. See? Very stable. Just like me. Okay? Very important. Play. I have a PhD. You know what that means? Play hard daily. Very important. Bench level experiments. This is starting to be the type. If I went and fitted this with sensors, maybe just dial gauges, and measured the force and the deflection, now I'm starting to get some real data. It's turning into a real experiment to test my hypothesis. You'll do experiments. Things will crash that you didn't think would crash. That's what the nature of experiments are. It's very, very critical that you test and break things and test your analytical hypotheses before you launch into the next design phase, which is where you actually start doing detailed analysis of calculation and creating real part drawings. All right, let's start with the next step, drawings. Now we're going to start getting the meat of how we really start putting your idea down. But you want to be very careful to stop and think a minute about what you're going to do. Drawings does not mean let's sit down at a CAD station and let's produce dimension drawings according to ISO standards. Yet. Okay? What we're doing meaning by drawings is we're starting to download from our brain onto our design notebooks what our thinkings or musings are. So here's my design notebook, and this is my very real design notebook. So for example, I can't tell you exactly why I'm doing this,
But here I have a sketch of this wavy surface, and I'm doing some calculations underneath it about arc lengths. This is a type of special structure that I'm working on. And you see, I've got here a sketch of my idea, and I'm starting to do calculations for the motions that are occurring, for the forces that I'm encountering in my machine. And that's what we mean by drawing now. We're going to move forward with how you start to, this is a model for a pendulum machine that ultimately was made in a solid model and then built. But this is the actual drawings to my notebook of how this evolved. This doesn't just happen by sit down and click and get pretty colored pictures. It starts from motion and force diagrams. We had an idea, and these are different types of contest tables in the past, for what we wanted to occur. And I start with hand sketches, no mechanical detail, just using arrows to indicate the direction of motion. And then, if you had the detailed mechanism, you lock yourself in too early. Okay? So for example, let's use our motion and force diagrams to start thinking about this table. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and assume that, and I'm going to do a plan view looking from the top, that here's the column and here is the part. And I'm going to assume that I just want to use revolute joints, round joints. Remember earlier I had sketched and I had started to put some thickness into these things like this. But see, that it makes it imply that it has to be this big. Maybe it's smaller, maybe it's bigger. Okay? So what I want to initially do is I want to take my part, and I'll just do it as a blob, and I'm going to do the volume in which it needs to be moved. So I need to reach everywhere in that volume. So for that center point to be from here to here and go to here, if my linkage is like this, it now needs to be able to move over to there. Sweep it through. So here is the motion that it has to go through. This is my bounding box of my motion, up to here, back to here, here, and here. So right away I can start thinking about, okay, what if this is the end, and here is the links like that. Can this design now move to reach that point? It can. So I can, with a drawing, start to explore that. When I start thinking about the forces from drilling, for example, coming down, force F applied here, I now know this lever arm, this total length of this is L, L, this is now 2L, and I can now start to think in terms of the forces that this joint will have to resist. When you're sketching things, that's the next step. See, now I just had a simple stick figure for the motions. Now I start sketching and I start putting some meat onto things to start get an idea of some detail and some design intent. In topic three, we're going to learn about this principle called Saint-Venet's principle, which says that if I want to control something, I grab it by 2 to 3 characteristic dimensions minimum, but 3 to 5 is really good. If I don't want something to be in control of me, I stay away 3 to 5 characteristic dimensions. So let's ask ourselves in this case, how would I start to sketch what this thing would actually look like? And we'll use a different color. Let's do blue. What in here is my characteristic dimension? If you don't know, take something that you think exists, because remember, I'm going to retrofit this machine, so this pole design here, D. And here is this length over here, so if this is D, and that's the farthest I'm going to reach, and I've got to do these revolute joints of motion. Now I can start thinking of sketching. Well, if I sketch something that looks like this, would you buy that? D. I want when I'm way out there to not be woggling too much? Should I be something like this? Watch what happens and look at the dimensions. This is my joint. Here's my table at the end. That starts to look a little bit more reasonable as a sketch. Well, should it go even further? Should it be, and notice this here is about 1.6D. What happens if I go down like 3D? Now it starts to look really much more significant. You could really put some load on the end of that thing. Okay, and how much is the cost? What is the minimum required? This starts to give a picture, and you said, I don't know which I like, this one or that one. Then draw two sketches. Sketches are very, very fast to do, okay? And it lets you do different concepts far faster than you ever would by right away going to a solid model. And the nice thing about sketches are, if you don't like them, it's really easy to erase them and start over. Plus, sketches are something you can do in your notebook at a meeting when you're really tired and bored, and you can go ahead and sketch your machine. Now, you shouldn't do that when you're supposed to be paying attention. We don't want that to happen. But sometimes, in between things, you have spare time, so you might as well be useful, okay? Now that you've got your sketch of your idea, what you want to do, now you would go and start to look at making a solid model. A solid model, something you're going to make on the computer by one of many drawing programs that exist. And we started with, we had this idea for our part. And here's the upper arm. And here's the table. Now, this is D, and I know that this is probably going to have to be on the order of greater than 1.6D. Where that 1.6 comes from, in a minute you'll see, because remember, 1.6 kilometers per mile, go the extra mile in your design, or 1.6 is the ratio of the golden rectangle. This L should be less than 3 to 5, times this engagement length, 1.6D. This is how I'm starting to lay out my sketch with these fundamental proportionalities of machines, which you'll learn a lot about in topic 3, the philosophy and actually the math behind where they come from. But now you see I'm starting to be able, with these basic ideas, be able to sketch out things. Now, to go to the solid model, now I can click and start creating these parts and start building the solid model of my machine. And I haven't really done a lot of analysis yet. We will be doing a lot of that. But it allows me to start building a more solid picture of what the machine will look like, which will help trigger doing the detailed analysis. A lot of times, I will go into my detailed analysis from this before I do the solid model. Depends on your experience level, okay? And also depends on what you're comfortable with. But in the end, you have to do both. Very important. Okay, we're going to have a separate module where I'm just going to be modeling, and you'll see the screen magically appear and hear my voice, but not me, where we're going to be doing the solid model of this machine. Okay, because that works a lot faster and a lot less boring than having the film, having me click. Okay?